go ahead and get this started. Thank you for being here tonight. Let's please stand for the prayer of pledge of allegiance. Bow our heads if you wish. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for that we're here to do better for this community. We ask you to guide us and direct us in our decisions and our processes through this community. We ask you to just be with us and be with those who serve our community, be with the residents, and be those that need your healing hands wrapped around them during this time of struggles. We ask you to be with the Vetter family as Kirsten goes through some difficult times with her surgery and all those who maybe have lost loved ones here in our community. Again, we come to you and just thank you for your blessings and your love and your kindness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call.
Bassett.
Here.
Beverly.
Here.
Miller.
Here.
Martin.
Here.
Eglin.
Here.
All right, next we're going to do, bring Rob Bailey, Robert Bailey III is that official title. So we will do an oath of office and meet you folks front here, Rob. Close to the cameras, right? All right, you got left hand on the Bible, you going to hold that for me? Right hand up. I, Robert Bailey.
I, Robert Bailey.
Do hereby solemnly swear.
Do hereby solemnly swear.
That I shall support the Constitution.
That I shall support the Constitution.
Of the United States.
Of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of Ohio.
And the Constitution of the State of Ohio.
And the ordinances of the Village of Hicksville.
And the ordinances of the Village of Hicksville.
I shall not be influenced by.
Shall not be influenced by.
Any consideration except.
Any consideration except.
That of merit and fitness.
That of merit and fitness.
Any appointment or discharge.
Appointment and discharge.
Of employees.
Of employees.
I shall not make.
Shall not make.
Or authorize the expenditure.
Or authorize the expenditure.
Of public money.
Of public money.
Except for the consideration.
Except for the consideration.
An efficient service to the village.
An efficient service to the village.
I shall faithfully.
I shall faithfully.
Honestly and impartially.
Honestly and impartially.
Discharge the duties of.
Discharge the duties of.
A member of the Council for the Village of Hicksville.
Member of the Council of the Village of Hicksville.
Defiance County, Ohio.
Defiance County, Ohio.
For the term ending December 31st.
The term ending December 31st.
2025.
2025.
To which I have been selected.
To which I have been selected.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Very good. Congratulations. Welcome. Thank you. Talked to John Hager today. He is not planning on being here tonight to discuss some property. Maybe come at another later meeting. So pass that along. We have approval of the January 15th regular council meeting minutes.
Any motion to approve is written.
Second it.
Roll call.
Bassett.
Yes.
Beverly.
Yes.
Eglin.
Yes.
Martin.
Yes.
Miller.
Yes.
Bailey.
Yes.
Got a bill list in front of you. Have any questions, concerns?
I do. Says pool filter, $27.51.93. We paid to have that built?
It's not built. Nope. That was about 203 tons worth of dirt brought in. So we pulled the plug on filling it. I reached out to some excavating companies to bring us some dirt when they get something to fill it in. And then whatever we get during the splash pad project.
Exactly, yeah. How about Trueland equipment for $68.89? What, sure. That'd be that little case skid steer, huh?
The skid steer was that 329E that we have on the street department. It had some issue where it didn't want to rev up, end up being some type of sensor that was almost $500. We had about $785 in labor on it, but a good portion of that money was $5,288 for a new plow for the 450.
Plow for the 450.
We replaced the plow.
On a dump truck? You got a dump truck from Trueland?
No. It was a 2022 F-450 that we got. It's got the stainless bed on it. We put a heavier plow on it.
Okay.
So that was, the price of that new plow was $5,288.
And that's involved in the $6,889?
Yes.
So you got a plow from Trueland?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, not a truck, a plow.
Truck, yeah.
And not for the skid steer.
Yeah.
So it's a combination of some invoices.
That was the one that they had $1,600 or $1,800 2 years in a row, two out of 3 years.
That's about $1,300 for repair, yeah.
Okay, that's all I got. Make a motion to pay the bills?
Second.
I'll second that.
Roll call.
Miller?
Yes.
Bailey?
Yes.
Beverly?
Yeah.
Martin?
Yes.
Bassett?
Yes.
Eglin?
Yes.
Any boards, commission updates? Council committee reports. I believe you have a PFE one in here.
Yes. You guys have in your packet the notes from the PFE meeting. It was pretty lengthy, about 2 hours. We got a lot discussed during that time. Bruce Silcott, unfortunately, he's not able to be here tonight because of his work schedule, because there are five Mondays in January. It flipped, so he's opposite of the council schedule now. He did give us a pretty nice write-up of some different ideas and plans that he has. Anyone that would like to see this, I have this copy. This is mine. It's got some notes in it, but you guys are more than welcome to look at it. He proposed some pretty big numbers and some pretty big ideas. He initially asked for 8 part-time employees. Obviously, 8 part-time employees may not be in the budget right now, and we have some other things that we have to discuss, including billing and what that'll look like. Just a personal opinion, though, we asked them to do a contingency plan. They did it. We asked them to select someone to help run the EMS. They did it. We asked them to work on their protocols. They're 50% of the way through those protocols. I just think as a council, we need to figure out a way to help that committee and support them so that they can continue to thrive. He has some pretty good ideas on helping to generate money. And if you understand the EMS, it doesn't really generate money. So he's kind of found some ways through transport of how we can do that. I was able to have a conversation with him and asked him, bottom line, how many employees would you need to get transporting up and running? Because that's basically how we're going to end up generating some money for that department. He felt like 2 part-time paramedics is what he would need to get started. So I really would like us to have some conversation about that in the near future, about allowing that to happen. We also need to maybe discuss the idea of coming up with a formal job position. I know he's kind of been selected into this role as a coordinator, is what they're calling it, but there really is a need for maybe a full-time coordinator position, and we need to discuss what that looks like in terms of budget and numbers and title. Yeah, I don't know if you guys have any questions. Also, one of the things discussed in here was an outside billing company. The date in the packet is February 20th. However, the lady out of Cleveland is able to come next Monday. I would like for us to have a special council meeting next Monday so that we can have her come in and she can talk to us. She has been in contact with Abby Franz and has told Abby, kind of led her to believe, that she could get us up and running within 30 days. She will be able to go back through all of the books, kind of figure out where some of our deficits are, and get us up and running again. I just think that we have not done any billing since December, and that is something that we need to get going on. I'm not sure how that goes about getting that scheduled, but I would really like to get her sooner than later.
Right. I was planning on scheduling a special council meeting for the 12th, since she was able to move it up a week. Spoke to several people about that, so
okay.
Like to see that happen.
Well, I had just a couple things on that. Where'd that $300,000 come from for transports? Is that a year?
Really?
So
So that's the way that they make their money. So this is projected income. This is not actual numbers.
Well, how many people are they transporting to make $300,000 in a year?
I will say, so I'll pass this along to you. Take a look at it or contact Bruce. He does a much better job explaining it than I do. He was actually in talks with CMH, Betty from down at CMH, about how many patients they had transferred out. So he got his numbers, and it's a mileage fee. And based on whether it's BSL or ASL, so that's the severity of the patient, they get a higher or lower mileage fee. So he was basing those numbers off of numbers that he got specifically from CMH.
Okay, and then on that plan, is that if the hospital stays open?
Yes.
But didn't we ask Bruce to come up with something for closing?
Yes, it's all in here. Yes.
Well, I just wanted to make sure.
Yeah, it is. He did.
Because we've been waiting on that.
Yep.
How many pages is it?
I don't know.
I mean, is it enough?
I would say it's probably a small willow tree, maybe.
Well, I didn't know if it's scanned versus.
We can get it, yeah, we can get it, or I can even ask Bruce if we can get it emailed to you. Honestly, if you have a chance.
Because I don't want to take the whole thing.
If you have a chance to sit down and talk to him, he went page by page and explained it to us, and that's really the best way to get that. And he may be able to come maybe next Monday.
Yeah, I'll have to check his schedule and everything.
Yeah, that might work out that he could possibly come. Hearing the presentation from him is significantly better than hearing it from me.
Yeah, because some of the numbers just looked a little bit.
They're projected numbers.
Sky high.
Yeah. I mean, I'm sure it's a bit wishful thinking, and it's based on having paramedics hired. And you know, paramedics cost a little bit more for the village to pay their income, so we're going to have to figure that out.
But didn't he get his transport numbers from the hospital themselves?
Yes, he got the amount of transfers from the hospital, and then I think the number of reimbursement he got right from Medicare and Medicaid website.
Correct.
And he's been in talks with them as well.
Because, you know, they're waiting on transports all the time. You know, that Spirit.
It seemed like a lot of money for.
So.
Well, it was eye-opening the amount of money that's been sitting there that we could potentially have captured over the years.
We talked about this a long time ago, about doing transports, and things fell through. Not from our end, but we had, I mean, lined up to do the transfers and sent in paramedic school. Things fell through on their end, and we weren't able to do that.
It's been a topic for most of my time up here. One thing that you, everybody that's got this sheet, you can take that 250K ambulance off of there because we found out what was wrong. Or I didn't find out, but it was found out what was wrong with that ambulance that's over there, and it's been fixed, and there's nothing wrong with it. So that 250 is no longer in play.
Well, and that 208,000 for the employee, that's 8 part-time paramedics. So also that number is high in terms of coming to the table, scaled back a little bit, and maybe just looking at 2 part-time paramedics.
Yeah, that's based on 24 hours a week.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, maybe Bruce, does he feel confident you can find part-time paramedics when we can't find basic EMT people?
He said he had 2 that night that would have willing to come work.
I'm assuming it's probably some people that he works with now.
And it was based on it being part-time, so they can have other jobs. It was people who were basically just willing to pick up extra shifts, kind of make extra money on the side.
But I thought we were considering them at 32 hours,
24 hours.
Well, they were going to do 24-hour shifts, so it had to stay under 32 hours.
So they don't pay for
it. Although, didn't you say 29 hours?
29 is what the you have to average. So it has to average out at the end of the year for the benefits and insurance. It has to average out at 29 hours or less.
Okay.
All right. So, in other words, if you have someone, you know, I would do this at the sheriff's office, I would have them, like, I might have them work 3 days, 1 week, and may not use them for 2 weeks. You know, and then I could work them more in that week because I'm still going
to
average out at the end of the year for the 29 hours.
Okay.
That's where the insurance thing kicks in, whether you have to pay the insurance or you don't.
Yeah.
So.
And then it'll really kind of take some time for the coordinator to figure that out and make sure they stay within that number.
I think for a preliminary report that he had given us with different options, I think he did a good job.
Yeah.
I mean, overall, with the different ways of kind of pulled things together, depending on situations with the hospital and our staffing and everything, so definitely to discuss a lot further.
Yeah.
I think the sunshine down the road is the February 12th meeting, that woman. I mean, the things that she tells that she can do, and she can do it all in 30 days. And you can make that, right?
Anybody else have any questions for?
I just had one. I see that towards the end, the results of the investigation were emailed. Are we going to be, the rest of the council members going to know what the investigation showed, or? I mean, I'm on personnel, so kind of curious. I'm the chairman of it, so I'm kind of curious.
I kept it with police, fire, and EMS just due to family connections with certain people on council and administration.
But there's other employees that are not family that were also on that list too, so I was kind of curious where we stood with it.
Yeah, we had the investigation, Rachel, and dealt with it and had a direction with it, so that's where we stood at the present time, so. But if we need to talk any farther about due to personnel, you know, issues, we have to go to executive, so.
Okay.
Really a matter of public record, though, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, because I like to talk into a little further, I guess. Because the things that happened to cause the EMS to be down, I don't want them to happen again. And if we don't know what caused it, kind of hard to correct your wrongs.
Like I said, we talked quite a bit. I mean, we've had a lot of discussion on the table and with the direction of what they went. I would advise going into executive session for it, so. Any other questions? Next, we have administrator's report.
On Wednesday, January 17th, we had another service line break out to 110 Middle Lane. It's the first time for that address, but that's eight of them out there since 2021. Friday on the 27th, we had a water main break at 400 block of Elm Street, which is right across from the recycling lot. It took a few hours to remedy that situation. I am in the process of writing a grant, a CDBG grant. This would be for a year 2025 to potentially replace that water main on Elm Street and would go from Usalagon to Cornelia Street. We did have a splash pad pre-construction meeting with myself and the engineers, Nagel, and the Hicksville Community Foundation. The foundation is currently in the process of picking out the fixtures for the splash pad and the colors of the fixtures for the splash pad. We are projected to go to construction the very beginning of April, and as of now, the project is scheduled for completion on August 1st. Spoke with Rachel, and she is put together an agreement, a payment schedule agreement that would be between the village and the foundation. We have also discovered a lot of infiltration, a lot of clear water coming in from the Haver Drive area. Actually, there's quite a bit of it. Haver Drive lift station, since we've had snow and ice melt off and some rain, that thing is running a lot more than what Defiance Avenue is running. So the Joel and Josh have been out cammering the laterals. There's 6-inch lines that go into the manholes out there, then they split off into 2 4-inchers going to the homes. And Joel's got more information on all this, and he can address you guys as well. But we're finding a lot of water coming in from those, and we don't know if the laterals have come apart like we have found in the past, or if there's something tied into them, but we are getting a lot of water in the sanitary from that. We are also having, it's mainly 2 addresses, and I won't put it out there, where we're getting a lot of grease in the sanitary lines. We have cleaned out one of them ourselves, and one of the businesses has hired a company to clean out the grease residue that was backing them up from another business. But I just want to remind people that there is an ordinance for that as well. And if a person is potentially charged with it. They can be charged with a misdemeanor and fined up to $1,000 per offense for dumping grease down into the sanitary system. Other than that, that's all I got. I did send an email.
Yeah, I can cover it down.
Yep.
Here about, schedule something tonight about the zoning inspector position, because Mike's gonna be retiring, so. So that'll be after this meeting.
Maybe we should go into executive session at the end of this and talk about a few things.
Anything else for Corey? Got a solicitor report, Rachel?
Well, here, second reading of ordinance 2023-19 by caption only to amend the annual appropriations ordinance and declaring an emergency.
Vote to suspend the rules.
Guess what are the changes? Well, how come for all the proposed changes?
Because I couldn't finish out the fire EMS payroll for the end of 2023 without doing this. Had to increase their revenue, and then I have to do an appropriation ordinance just to close out 2023. That's why December's still open.
I'll second that.
Roll call.
Bassett?
Yes.
Beverly?
Yes.
Bailey?
Yes.
Egley?
Yes.
Martin?
Yes.
Miller?
Yes.
I suspend, yeah.
Second.
Final reading.
No, that was second reading, so third and final.
So do third and final. Third and final reading of ordinance 2023-19 by caption only to amend the appropriations and declaring an emergency.
So moved.
Second.
Roll call.
Miller?
Yes.
Martin?
Yes.
Egley?
Yes.
Bassett?
Yes.
Beverly?
Yep.
Bailey?
Yes.
We have a first reading of ordinance 2024-04 by caption only authorizing fiscal officer to transfer funds and declaring an emergency.
I'm assuming the $500,000 for the splash pad capital projects, or is that, or, I know we have paid some money possibly upfront on that one.
Yeah.
Is that what that's for, or is that?
Yeah, that's what it's for.
Okay.
And that one is not technically an emergency, of course, but the 50 to go into police and fire definitely is, because we're already in negative.
You're working on the payment, repayment plan on, I know there's some concerns on getting the money, and they, splash pad committee said that they were gonna give $800,000, and
Right.
they haven't given it over yet, so.
I gave Corey, I sent an agreement that I proposed, or wrote up yesterday.
I move to suspend the rules.
I'll second.
Roll call.
Bailey?
Yes.
Beverly?
Yep.
Bassett?
Yes.
Egley?
Yes.
Martin?
Yes.
Miller?
Yes.
Second and final reading of ordinance 2024-04 by caption only authorizing fiscal officer to transfer funds and declaring an emergency.
So, second.
Roll call.
Miller?
Yes.
Bailey?
Yes.
Beverly?
Yes.
Martin?
Yes.
Bassett?
Yes.
Egley?
Yes. Second reading of resolution 2024-02 by caption only to enter a contract with Choice One Engineering for the Meadow Lane and Beverly Drive Water Service Replacement Project and declaring an emergency.
Any idea why that's so high, Corey? I mean, they're gonna replace water service, so they know each house has one. I mean, there's not a lot of engineering that really goes into something like that.
I think 6,000, 4,000 I think is their base. Is their base fees.
I see several of the other ones were 44.
Yeah, 44.
And those seem like they would contain more paperwork than these others. And this one, I just wondered why it was so high. I hope they're not gonna turn into another engineering firm that used to do a lot of work for us.
I can send you the breakdown.
I Yes.
Bailey?
Yes.
Miller?
Yes.
Martin?
Yes.
Eggly?
Yes. Third and final reading of Resolution 2024-02 by caption only to enter a contract with Choice in Engineering for the Meadow Lane and Beverly Drive Water Service Replacement Project and declaring emergency.
So move.
Second.
Roll call.
Eggly?
Yes.
Martin?
Yes.
Miller?
Yes.
Beverly?
Yes.
Bassett?
Yes.
Bailey?
Yes.
First reading of Resolution 2024-03 by caption only to enter a contract with Choice in Engineering for the valve replacement project and declaring emergency.
Motion to suspend the rules.
Why are these emergencies?
I want to get, I want to get them bid out and get them done.
Okay.
I'll second.
Roll call.
Bassett?
Yes.
Eggly?
Yes.
Beverly?
Yep.
Martin?
Yes.
Bailey?
Yes.
Miller?
Yes.
Second and final reading of Resolution 2024-03 by caption only to enter a contract with Choice One Engineering for the valve replacement project and declaring emergency.
So move.
Second.
Roll call.
Bassett?
Yes.
Beverly?
Yep.
Bailey?
Yes.
Miller?
Yes.
Martin?
Yes.
Eggly?
Yes.
First reading of Resolution 2024-04 by caption only to enter a contract with Choice One Engineering for the water tower demolition project and declaring emergency.
Make a motion to suspend the rules.
Second.
Roll call.
Bassett?
Yes.
Eggly?
Yes.
Beverly?
Yep.
Martin?
Yes.
Bailey?
Yes.
Miller?
Yes.
Second and final reading of Resolution 2024-04 by caption only to enter a contract with Choice One Engineering for the water tower demolition project and declaring an emergency.
So move.
Second.
Roll call.
Miller?
Yes.
Bailey?
Yes.
Martin?
Yes.
Beverly?
Yep.
Bassett?
Yes.
Eggly?
Yes.
There you go. Good job. Thank you, everybody. Next on the agenda is department heads. Chief Denning, do you have anything?
You should have stats for January, stats for cases and calls for service. The other thing is request for executive session for personnel, for additional personnel, basically to finalize the K-9 program. And I think our new car, new Durango, I found out last week hasn't been, went to the production line yet. So it's scheduled not to go to the production line at least till March. So we probably won't see it till at least end of April, May. So.
Will that be K-9 ready?
That, we're, the 2021 vehicle is what we're going to put the K-9 in.
It can be like retrofitted for that?
Yeah, we just got to order kennel. So I can talk about this in executive, but yeah, we're going to put it in 2021. We can't get it. It's how quick this class is coming up. Durango's not going to be here anyways, but I plan on using it in 2021.
Okay.
So, but that's all I've got.
Any questions for the chief? Very good. Thank you. Chief Hart.
511, we had trouble with it. That was our second squad we have. We repaired that. It was a short. We did that in-house, so we saved a little money that way. Also, last weekend, the hospital was on a diversion. So any calls we had was going someplace else. We did have one call transferred to Fort Wayne, so if you're looking at it, it's a little more bucks than what we transferred out here to Hicksville. Things went well. It was like over and back. They were back in about 2 hours. So did a nice job on that. Not all of them are going to be that way, but.
You only had one run?
We had a.
Over the weekend?
Yeah, we only had one run, yeah. So we were lucky this weekend. I mean, not having to take it out of town and have a second call and all that sort of stuff, so. That's all I have right at the moment. Any questions?
100-foot ladder truck, did you find out if it's NFPA certified?
I couldn't find anything. I couldn't find anything. There's nothing in the files stating it is.
You have to have it inspected. You have to have it inspected yearly.
Yeah, we're going to have to then if we want to keep it.
We've got to use it, yeah.
Yeah, so. I'll get on that.
It has to be certified to even sit in that building, probably. Seriously.
Yeah, it's an asset for us to have it, so.
If you can legally use it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we just, you know, we can't take it out in the country because that'll suck more water than what we can have at the point on time. So we don't take it out of town.
I know you have a lot of things going on over there, Bruce, but I would kind of make that a priority and get some phone calls made and get somebody to come over here to see if we can, if it's even possible to certify the thing.
Yeah, I agree. And I'm going to check in on all the other ladders also, so.
Is it a one-time certification or?
Yearly,
no.
Yearly tested, yeah. If it can't be certified, then they can't use it whether it's in town or around the country. They shouldn't be using it at all.
We can back them down, like the pump test. If it don't beat the 1,000 gallon a minute, we can back it down to 750, but that hurts our, insurance rates.
The main thing that's going to be certified on that unit is the ladder. Mm-hmm.
Is the ladder, yep.
Yeah. That's the main thing they're going to look at.
So, I'll work on that.
There's companies in Fort Wayne to do that.
Good, because I don't know where to go with it. Honestly, I don't. Down in Finley, I suppose we could go, but that's another day's ride. If we get in Fort Wayne, that's better off we are.
I'll get with you tomorrow. Give you some numbers in Fort Wayne of trucking companies that do it. Truck repair shops that do it.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Anything else?
Have a question for Chief. Thank you, Chief. Parks Department here today, but hey, Joel's here from the updates. Joel.
Yeah. I can come off what Corey just told you guys about.
You want to go this?
Yeah, I can. About Haver Drive. We did a lot of camera work this past week. We've had a lot of rain, a lot of snow melt. This past month, we had roughly 3.5 inches of rain. Just in 8 days, we had 2 inches of rain and total precipitation. So not only did we have 2 to 3 inches of snow, we had also the 2 inches of rain. Ground is super saturated, so it takes a long time to go away. And like Corey said, Haver, it was up 250% on its normal run time, over its normal run time. It usually runs about an hour a day. It's running right now, even after we left all the rain, it's about 2 hours a day, double. Back at its peak, it was running about 2.5 times its normal runtime at about 350%. So all the other stations were up. The only one that was excluded was industrial. It was so minimal, you couldn't see a difference when it came to the actual rain and INI. Trident, we found an issue with Trident. We're gonna take care of here soon. With all the snow melt and the rain, it was getting back down into our valve pit, and the engineer put a hole in the bottom, draining back into the lift station. So all that melt just added so many hours to the rundown on those pumps. So we're gonna fix that here fairly quick. Make sure that doesn't happen, especially with Fan Crest coming online here soon. I don't know when they're supposed to come on. I thought they were gonna come online in January. But apparently not, but that's all the way across the board. Yoder's up, Hillbrook's up, Defiance Avenue, Haver even ran longer than Defiance. Out on Haver, we found at least three direct sources of water. We can only feed the push camera up so many lines. We found one on an empty lot, and I'm going to leave the other two residences unnamed for right now. We'll still do the research, what we can find. Pulled manholes all the way through town, just possible sources, trying to find other sources. Long term would be more just like rain meters. Put rain meters in all through town, check those before and after rain, just direct sources, keep removing them. So, but on that note, you guys have any questions?
Are we staying down so that we're not bypassing down at the plant?
Right now we are not. So we're good, we have. So all those are always reported to the finance health department and to the EPA whenever that happens. We get to a certain point, we do bypass. It's not on every one of them. 003, 004, 006, those are our three main ones. 003 is our main bypass or our CSO location. It does happen. We're trying to eliminate that, but we have to reduce a lot more INI, reduce a lot more sources of direct inflow that are getting into our sanitary, or else it won't go away. But every year we make strides to remove as much as we can. So
it's on three, is that, that's an old tile, right?
That's the main one that comes into the plant. Big line.
Okay.
Thank you, Joel. Appreciate it.
And I have a few more things. You told me to put together a list for 2024. Just the project list, what we plan on doing.
Okay.
So we have, currently I went through it today, we have 7 to 8 manholes we need to raise through town. We find more and more every day. That's our goal, to get those done this year. 2 to 3 catch basins that we found. I'm sure there's more that are going to be raised or replaced. The West Digester, as you know, we rebuilt the East Digester last year. We have all the diffusers to replace in the West this year. Received quotes from two different companies. I'm trying to get better pricing on those. Sanitaire is kind of locked down which place they want to go through, because there's different divisions, North, South Division, on who can actually sell to us. BL Anderson can't sell to us, but BL Anderson, and then there's Bergren. Bergren can only sell sanitary products to us, which is what we have in the tanks now. So I'm going in a different direction through aftermarket. See if we can save some money, see if there's a way that the actual warranty is the same. The warranty is very similar. We might go with the aftermarket option. It'll save us some money. This year we plan on doing a lot more camera work and jet work. Just want to identify more places, INI, like I talked about, more future linings. We'll get those done as well. And then the last thing would be, I'm sure I'm missing some things, but our drying beds. As you know, we still have a lot of sludge, and we're working as much as we can to try and get it out. So this year, at least, we're going to start redoing some of those, because it's just packed with sludge. Replace sand, replace stone, so they perform better. Of course, it's all on the mercy of the weather, how well they work. And I can't control that, I wish I could. So I've been working with several companies for a future sludge project. And they're sending in proposals, just like an idea of what it would cost in the future to have a full-time press at the plant, so I can run it as much as we want, and we would never fall behind on solids. Because the detriment of any plant in the United States is solids handling. If you can't process your solids, you can't get rid of them, your plant deteriorates. So that's why I try to kind of jump the gun, try to get these things rolling, so we can, in future time, I talked to Mike about it the other day, we can get something in here. So it's just gonna be a benefit for us. Even submitted a grant, what was it, this last month, maybe 2 months ago, through the state of Ohio, to see if we can get some money towards that. So we'll see how that goes. But that's all I got.
Thank you for your help.
Thank you, appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you. Fiscal Officer Cheryl?
As you can tell, we've been one month into 2024. We have revenue of $516,000. We've spent $717,000. So a good start. Secondly, you have the Union Cemetery cash flow for the year 2023 and the budget for 2024. I have a new form for you that's showing all of the donation lines that we have running right now in our financials and how much we're taking in so far even in 2024. The current list of revolving loans and hard pressed copy is not 450%, 4.5. Forgot the decimal point. Then you have the utility report for January as well as the income tax. Income tax is up 3%, which is really good for January. You have the franchise fee payments from MediaCom from the fourth quarter of 23. And that's all of the financial things, except I need to have you do the Monty Valley contract. We haven't had a contract, and they asked me if I had a copy of one from way back when, and I did not, and neither did they. So this is new. So I sent it to you in a separate email. You can look it over before tonight.
I guess, in a nutshell, why do they want paid now? They used to take a percent of, like, say, a CDBG grant, they would take their cut out of that. So they still doing that, plus we're paying them?
Plus the money we paid them.
Right. So do you want to, you know, say yes or no, or do you want them to come in and talk to you, or how do you want to handle it?
I'd say no, and then see if Dennis wants to come and talk to us.
Are these hourly rates standard for the most part? I mean, this is what they've charged us in the past, or?
We've had a flat rate.
What made them decide to?
I don't know.
Go with an hourly rate?
I think you need to come in and talk to us.
Please.
I give Dennis a call and see if he can make the next council meeting, or go.
I will.
At the 12th, the 20th?
No, right, that's a Tuesday, not the Monday prior, so. Any other questions for Cheryl? We've got some notes here real quick. First off, you know, we had talked about seeing if we want to eliminate the partisan seats on council. We've talked about that several times over the years. To see if we want to move forward with that. I actually reached out to the Board of Elections. It would be, we would not do any primaries for the council seats. They would be, everything would be set to the general election and then tally the votes, if it's one seat, you know, one for the top person, two, vice versa, kind of thing. So since the last, reaching out to Tanya at the Board of Elections, we'd have to get about 87 signatures from the village. They can be Republican, Democrat, Independent, any party. If we want to move forward with that and then present them, Rachel would have to do some paperwork for the Board of Elections to move that forward to be on the ballot then in November to go nonpartisan council seats. So we've talked about it for years. I think it was a good idea. We would, the primaries anymore, if people are not running for the seats, we encourage people to run. But we wouldn't have to go through any primaries, it would all be general election. So if you want to move forward with that, we can't, as a council or village employees, cannot solicit signatures. We'd have to get outside people to do that. So I've had a couple people I've reached out to if they would be able, willing to do that, they said they would, to collect signatures for us. And then it would go to Rachel, then back to the Board of Elections to be. Our August 7th is the deadline for all the paperwork. and the signatures to be on the ballot. So, your call.
Is there any benefit to that to save the village money?
Yeah.
That's right, that's how I understood it, is that?
Yeah, that last primary, just to be honest.
$12,000, $14,000. $14,000, it was $12,000 to $15,000, just because three people that were Republicans ran for two spots.
Yep.
And so we had to run primary and only, we could all win a general election and we wouldn't have to pay all that money.
Save a lot of money in different things that come along like that, and they do come along frequently.
I'm in favor of it.
I'm in favor, me too.
We have an official vote on it, both council, no vote, just.
Anyway, we can.
The people, you know, it's gonna go to the elections, so.
Because you're not in it.
Right.
Right.
I know that, I just said, the people have the vote, it's gonna go to the ballot, if they wanna have council that way, it's up to them, so.
Do the people that would run for those spots, do they, would they still require to get signatures from, like?
I think they still have to get, you know, I think they still have to get signatures, they just would be.
Much like you.
Partisan, yeah.
Yeah.
Because right now, with the setup of council with the original, you know, it's, there's no Republican seats or Democrat seats, but you gotta run that way, that seat, so.
Let's do it, Mike.
Sure, I will move forward with that then. I had sent everybody, we have a new, well, I didn't know if Rob wanted to go, we talked about it, but their OML is having council orientation class, new council members, but I'm gonna go to it. I would like to get refreshed on council procedures and different things like that. There's three meetings in March, one in Athens, Columbus, and then Cleveland. Seeing if anybody else wanted to ride along, go together, get it updated, or get an update on council, you know, programs for council seats and protocol stuff, so. Encouraging anyone to go to that class on any one of those dates. I did get an update here yesterday. An email went out about the Verizon Tower, an American Tower. They were reaching out again. Mark Warnicki had reached out to Jen, I can't remember her last name, I had the email, but they're like, what's the holdup? They're getting, we're getting frustrated. It's been a long time, about 2 year process. And they're still saying it's in there, on their desk, it's not priority anymore kind of thing. And we're like, you know what, enough's enough. So, talking to Mark with all that stuff, and Erica was part of the email, I mean, we're to the point of, if we're gonna move further, we might have to go to litigation on them. I mean, to move them quicker. Are we just gonna sit there?
Throw them out.
But I think we've got plenty of due diligence to, it's a simple move. And they even said it was a simple move. I think Verizon was okay with it, but the other parties were kind of holding it up, but.
We'll mess around and lose out on an awfully big chance for this village.
Yeah. Erica had said she had two different parties kind of reach out and said if they had a facility available, they were kind of wanting to move on something, but that was a year or so ago, so. None of the property has been moved over to the Keller. You know, he doesn't have any of the property. He had to get this taken care of before we were moving in any farther with moving the property into his possession, so. But I'm glad he kind of reached out to him again. They got some movement on it, but they didn't say it was a priority anymore.
So let's do whatever we have to do.
And I don't know if Rachel's real up to date with that. Troy worked on it several times with Mark Warnicki, but I can get you the information of where we stand, and Troy should have.
Troy gave me a copy of, I guess it was the contractor, something that he had in his possession regarding that.
Correct.
I just haven't had a chance to look over it yet, but.
So we probably have to get back with Mark on it.
Yeah.
Move a direction on that, so we will talk to him on that.
Rachel, do you have an actual copy of the easement? Does anybody have one?
I have to check. Troy gave me a big envelope of stuff regarding it, but I will look in it and see what's in there.
Very good. Sorry, we did have a proclamation, I won't read the whole thing, but every February, the Fort County Career Service has a luncheon. The students get to show off their designs, their classes, their projects within the Fort County school. And it's a nice program. I had an opportunity to go last year. but they call February the Career Technical Education Month. It's a nice school, they do a lot of nice stuff for our kids, with some direction with job opportunities and see finding their interest in certain fields. But the proclamation, and they got a Friday luncheon, but I take this over and I'll have it signed off on, but, you know, Hicksville recognizes the month of February as Career and Technical Education Month, so we'll go ahead and go to that meeting. I don't know if I had anything else.
Mike, backing up to the seminar you were talking about, I was just reading this again, and the payment deadline for, I think, the one that we were talking about going to in Columbus, payment deadline's February 23rd.
Yeah.
So we might want to make a decision pretty quickly.
Right, anybody that, yeah.
We're going to do.
We talked about maybe going down to the Columbus.
Athens is just too far.
Right.
Yeah. 5 hours in the car is ideal.
We were thinking, if anybody did one, we talked about maybe going down to the Columbus one and carpool one down, so if anybody else wants to go, you're more welcome to. Let me know, or let Cheryl know, and Columbus is, what, 3 hours? Cleveland's the last one, I think, in the month, a little bit farther, but 23rd, so let us know quickly. Anything else for the council?
I make a motion we go into executive session to discuss what?
Personnel.
Personnel and something else.
K-9?
No. That's under personnel, additional.
Additional personnel.
Yeah, additional personnel. Just personnel and some more additional personnel.
Okay.
One second.
Roll call.
Taylor?
Yes.
Miller?
Yes.
Martin?
Yes.
Beverly?
Yep.
Bassett?
Yes.
Egley?
Yes.